Welcome to our service of worship here at St. John's Anglican Church in Bowmanville. We are delighted that you are here. Blessed are you, O Christ, Son of God. You were before time began and came into the world to save us. Blessed are you, Son of Righteousness. You shine with the Father's love and illumine the whole universe. Blessed are you, Son of Mary, born a child, you share our humanity.
Let heaven and earth shout their praise.
With all the voices of heaven, we celebrate the coming of our Savior.
Let heaven and earth shout their praise.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world. May your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, shine with the radiance of his glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of 1 Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." son, lie down again. Now, Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. And therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall speak and say, Lord, for your servant is listening." So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Hear what the Spirit is saying to us now.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food. And God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh. But anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Hear what the Spirit is saying to us now.
Thanks be to God.
Here I am.
Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see things greater than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened, and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Holy Spirit, speak in each of our hearts. Amen. It was a pattern that I saw as the parent of toddlers, which made a big impression on me at the time, although I did not understand it until years later. The pattern is that if two young children are standing in a room filled with toys, the toy a child wants most is the toy in the other child's hand. The child who wants the other child's toy will often revert to violence in order to get it. The French scholar René Girard, who has written on cultural anthropology and literary criticism before moving to an analysis of scripture, has observed this pattern as well. He describes it with the term mimetic desire. The child who wants the toy wants it not because of the characteristics of the toy. The child who sees the toy in the other child's hand wants that toy because she sees that the other child wants it. From the unconscious arises the desire for what another person desires, because the child unconsciously imitates the desire of the other child. Girard looks at the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue. He writes, "Commandments 6, 7, 8, and 9 are both simple and brief. They prohibit the most serious acts of violence in the order of their seriousness. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." The tenth and last commandment is distinguished from those preceding it, both by its length and its object. In place of prohibiting an act, it forbids a desire. You shall not covet the house of your neighbor. You shall not covet the wife of your neighbor, nor his male or female slave, nor his ox or his ass, nor anything else that belongs to him. Girard continues, "Without being actually wrong, translation leads readers down a false trail. The term covet suggests an uncommon desire is prohibited, a perverse desire reserved for hardened sinners. But the Hebrew term translated as covet means just simply desire. This is the word that designates the desire of Eve for the prohibited fruit, the desire leading to original sin. The notion that the Decalogue devotes its supreme commandment, the longest of all, to the prohibition of a marginal desire reserved for a minority is hardly likely. The desire prohibited by the Tenth Commandment must be the desire of all human beings. In other words, simply desire is such. While critics may bristle at the whole notion of religious prohibitions, Jerome looks deeper. He says, if individuals are naturally inclined to desire what their neighbors possess, or to desire what their neighbors even simply desire, this means that rivalry exists at the very heart of human social relations. This rivalry, if not thwarted, would permanently endanger the harmony and even the survival of all human communities. Rivalistic desires are all the more overwhelming since they reinforce one another. The principle of reciprocal escalation and one-upsmanship governs this type of conflict. This phenomenon is so common, so well known to us, and so contrary to our concept of ourselves, thus so humiliating, that we prefer to remove it from consciousness as if it did not exist. But all the while, we know it does exist. This indifference to the threat of runaway conflict is a luxury that small ancient societies could not afford. The commandment that prohibits desiring the goods of one's neighbor attempts to resolve the number one problem of every human community, internal violence. If a child tries to grab the toy in the hand of another child, the child holding the toy will want the toy all the more, which makes the other child's desire for it stronger, and the pattern escalates. As Gerard observes, mimetic rivalries can become so intense that rivals denigrate each other, steal each other's possessions, seduce the other's spouse, and finally, they even go so far as murder. The four prohibitions of the Decalogue. Just as we imitate the desires of our neighbors, we also imitate the hostility of our neighbors, which becomes contagious. Gerard calls it mimetic contagion. He writes, the crowd is still favorable to Jesus when he enters Jerusalem, but it turns suddenly against him, and its hostility becomes so contagious that it spreads to the most diverse individuals. The theme that dominates the narratives of the Passion, especially in the first three Gospels, is the uniformity of reactions among those involved. Peter is the most spectacular example of mimetic contagion. His love for Jesus is not a question. It is as sincere as it is profound. Yet, as soon as the apostle is plunged into a crowd hostile to Jesus, he is unable to avoid imitating its hostility. Gerard goes on to trace this pattern through Pilate and even the thieves crucified beside Jesus. He describes the way the violent contagion snowballs as it gathers momentum from the crowd. He explains, beyond a certain threshold of frustration, those in conflict are no longer content with objects themselves over which they are fighting. Mutually exasperated by the live obstacle, the scandal that is henceforth for the other, they become mimetic doubles and forget the object of their quarrel. They turn against each other with rage in their hearts. From now on, each sets against the other as a mimetic rival. As hostility attracts other hostility, Gerard says, the whole community is mobilized against one and the same individual. In the Passion, this individual is Jesus, which explains why Jesus resorts to vocabulary of scandal to designate himself as everyone's victim and to designate all those who are polarized against him. Jesus warns his disciples that they will all succumb, more or less, to the contagion that seizes the crowd. They will all participate to some extent in the passion on the side of the persecutors. Gerard explores the victim mechanism that is at the root of the patterns of lynchings and other forms of scapegoating and mob violence. The divided community at the height of the mimetic process reestablishes its unity against a single victim who becomes the supreme scandal because everyone, in a mimetic fervor, holds this one to be guilty. Satan is the violent contagion that persuades the entire community, which has become unanimous, that this guilt is real. He is the accuser of the hero in the book of Job, before God and even more so before the people. Once the unfortunate victim is completely isolated, deprived of defenders, nothing can protect her or him from the aroused crowd. Everyone can set upon the victim without having to fear the least reprisal. The victim may seem insignificant in relation to all the appetites for violence that are converging on him or her. But at this very moment, the community desires nothing other than the victim's destruction. No one in the community has an enemy other than the victim. So once this person is hunted, expelled, and destroyed, the crowd finds itself emptied of hostility and without an enemy. Only one enemy was left, who has been eliminated. Provisionally, at least, this community no longer experiences either hatred or resentment toward anyone or anything. It feels purified of all tensions, of all its divisions, of everything fragmented. The persecutors don't know that their sudden harmony, like their previous discord, is the work of contagious imitation. They believe they have on their hands a dangerous person, someone evil, of whom they must rid the community. Gerard explores the ways that societies in which anxiety is high project their anxiety on a scapegoat, often a person who is other than those in power, by race, gender, religion, ethnicity, or national origin. In unconscious mimesis, as they seek to destroy the scapegoat, they are convinced that the scapegoat will destroy them As they see the person they are victimizing, they are convinced that they are the true victim. The process begins with the public shaming of the victim and then escalates to violence. As first one person commits an act of violence, and then others imitate them, as mob violence develops, and the mob feels bonded by the experience. All of this is happening as people are not conscious of the way they are carrying out these primitive impulses, which of course makes them all the more powerful as we continue to believe, while the patterns keep repeating, that we are good people. Gerard explores the way the Old Testament and New Testament present descriptions that are both similar to the ancient myths and in one important way, different from them. One scholar summarizes his views this way. The Gospels ostensibly present themselves as a typical mythical account, with a victim god lynched by a unanimous crowd, an event that is then commemorated by Christians through ritual sacrifice, a material representation, in this case, in the Eucharist. The parallel is perfect except for one detail. The truth of the innocence of the victim is proclaimed by the text and the writer. Jesus is someone who is innocent. Gerard goes on. The mythical account is usually built on the lie of the guilt of the victim, inasmuch as it is an account of the event seen from the viewpoint of the anonymous lynchers. This ignorance is indispensable to the efficacy of the sacrificial violence. The good news clearly affirms the innocence of the victim, thus becoming, by attacking ignorance, the germ of the destruction of the sacrificial order on which rests the equilibrium of societies. Already, the Old Testament shows this turning inside out of the mythic accounts with regard to the innocence of the victims, such as Abel, Joseph, and Job. And the Hebrews were conscious of the uniqueness of their religious tradition. With the Gospels, it is with full clarity that things hidden since the foundation of the world, the foundation of the social order on murder, described in all its repulsive ugliness in the account of the Passion, are unveiled with full clarity. The Gospel Revelation contains the truth on the violence, available for 2,000 years, Gerard tells us. Has it put an end to the sacrificial order based on violence in the society that has claimed the gospel text as its own religious text? No, he replies. Since in order for a truth to have an impact, it must find a receptive listener. And people do not change that quickly. So much of what we see in the Gospels? Is humanity's desire to see ourselves as good people? And our tendency to respond with condemnation and even violence toward anyone who questions the self-deceptions that unconsciously drive us, as Jesus often does. The gospel is a reminder to us that Jesus sees us as we are, and even as we are, God loves us unconditionally. Let us confess the faith of our baptism using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Church, especially our diocesan Bishop Andrew, our area Bishop Priscilla, and our clergy, Lucia, Susan, Shirley, and Carol. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the Anglican Cycle of Prayer for the Anglican Church of Australia, and in the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer for the Bishop's Committee on Discipleship.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of St. John's, as we seek to know Jesus and make him known. For the whole people of God, that each one may be a true and faithful servant of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those drawing near to the light of faith, that the Lord will bring them to true knowledge of himself. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our families and friends, that the Lord will give them joy and satisfaction in all that they do. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our hearts and all those who are lonely, sick, hungry, persecuted, or ignored, that the Lord will comfort and sustain them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the lives of those who have gone before us, and we pray for those who grieve for them.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our country, that the Lord will help us to contribute to its true growth and well-being. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the whole human family, that we may live together in justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for Ngozi Obiakwo as she celebrates her birthday this week. Watch over your child, Ngozi. O Lord, as her days increase, bless and guide her wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she fall. And in her heart, may your peace, which surpasses understanding, abide all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We thank you for our church community at St. John's and for its ministries. We thank you for all of those whose gifts to our church make these ministries possible.
Amen.
Sits there all alone, her husband.
Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the God of peace enable us to do his will in every kind of goodness, working in us what pleases him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever.
Amen.